If you were to stroll with me beyond these gates into the garden, then you might not come out alive. Find out why and where I am in just a moment. As their work life winds down, today's house hunters are stepping up their search for a new life and a new venture. As our property search begins, there's excitement in the air.
Wow, can I say wow lots of times?
You said it three times, that's great.
Right, here comes a fourth. Wow.
And it's very much about what's outside our houses.
This is a room with an astounding view.
It's invigorating.
Today I'm in Northumberland and this is the Poison Garden, part of the superb gardens next to Alnwick Castle. It's based on a medieval herbalist plan, but with a twist, because all the species here are potentially lethal. Some of them are so deadly they require a license and are cultivated inside cages to protect the visitors. But don't worry, there are plenty of other vistas and landscapes in this great county without such a sting in their tail. As England's northernmost county, Northumberland borders Scotland, and to the east looks out over the North Sea. Its beautiful and rugged coastline extends for some 64 miles, and its natural splendour has earned it status as an area of outstanding natural beauty. The most sparsely populated county in England, there are just over 160 people per square mile, with around a quarter of the landmass given over to the Northumberland National Park. The population gathers in its towns and villages such as Alnwick and Allendale, whose main streets are lined with a harmonious mix of stone buildings. With its proximity to neighbouring Scotland, history books tell of border wars in the 14th to 16th centuries, with castles and ruins stark reminders of those times of conflict. In fact, the county boasts over 70 castle sites, more than any other in the country. With its mix of dramatic landscapes and history, Northumberland is well worth the journey for those truly wanting an escape. If you are looking for beautiful, wide open landscape like this, without a hefty price tag, then Northumberland might be the place to explore. The average price for a detached house in England's northernmost county is £244,000. That's £80,000 less than the rest of the country. Now, down south and by the coast, your pennies might feel the pinch, but there is no shortage of open space for a rural retreat. And that's definitely one of the factors that attracted our house buyers today. So let's meet them. Executive assistant Fergus and husband Graham, a furniture restorer, have lived in their four-bedroom mid-terrace property in Croydon, South London for 13 years. Their paths first crossed in cyberspace.
We met online through an online dating agency. He sent me an email and I answered and we got talking on the phone and relationship grew from there and then got married in Rome in September 2003.
And after saying ciao to Italy, they've never looked back.
She's got a bubbly personality, she's got a heart of gold.
Graham's my best friend. She's great company to be with and very kind, very warm personality.
The couple both work full-time, but with Graham's retirement around the corner and Ferga lessening her working week, they've decided they want to up sticks and relocate.
Northumberland is the area. We're looking at some wonderful places around there, so we're hoping we're going to get the perfect property.
Graham's formative years were spent in Nottinghamshire, and he's looking forward to heading north.
The north to me is my homeland and it's where I grew up and I have a lot of friends up there.
They'll also be closer to Graham's son and grandchildren in North Yorkshire.
As far as where we want to be in relation to them, I think we want to be about an hour and a quarter, an hour and a half away.
So we're close, but not on their doorstep, so that we can come together and share family times and good times together and that they know us. We love them to bits and, you know, we're very close.
After the restrictions of urban living, Ferga and Graham look forward to enjoying their hobbies with a bit more space.
I love being out in the garden, and what I'd like is something bigger with more
that you can get your teeth into.
Get my teeth into, exactly, yes.
I've always had an interest in stargazing, and one thing about Northumberland is they have what they call dark sky night, a protected area, and it's got the least light pollution, so you've got the best skies, and it's renowned now for stargazing.
But it won't all be downtime. Fergie will be commuting to her job in London, and Graham will still do some work from home, where they've also got plans to set up a new business.
One of our key things was to have an annex and to set up a holiday let. And that's why kind of location, I think, it was very key for us in that it's in the right area so that we have kind of natural beauty around us that people will actually want to come and see.
So with their property about to go on the market, the couple are ready to start their house hunt in earnest.
I'm really ready now to go to the country to kind of take a breath, exhale, and enjoy the pursuits of the country.
I think there comes a time in life where you've done all the hard work. Life can literally be not one long holiday, but much more enjoyable and doing natural things.
Which we hope to do.
As soon as you step out the door in an area which...
Mm-hmm. We love.
We love.
Mm-hmm. Fergie and Graham's friends are towards the north of Northumberland, and Fergie will be travelling to London to work and to stay there 3 days a week. But they're open to considering anywhere in the county, so we're taking all that into account. Welcome to Northumberland.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
It's a little cold.
And wet.
Cold and wet, but mm-hmm. You know, that is probably a feature of Northumberland.
We have to get used to it.
It's a gorgeous
it's
county.
It's just stunning, and even in the wet and the rain and the wind, and I think if you can like it then, when the sun shines, it's even better.
So it's a good time of life to be moving, particularly for you, Graham, because you've got sort of some more free time as you work less.
Yes, Alistair, yes, I'm looking to slow down as I near retirement.
And you are going to be commuting back and forth to London.
I am, for
crazy
3 days
lady.
A week.
But what sort of a commute are you looking for? What time is acceptable?
To get to the station. I don't mind, because I think the house, that whatever we're going to have, is our forever home. And so I can live with the travelling. So within an hour.
And in terms of the house, you said it's going to be your forever home. What are you looking for?
Internally, minimum 3 bedrooms we'd like. Big rooms or big-ish rooms. Kitchen, big kitchen. I'd love a big kitchen. It can be a kitchen diner or it can be 2 separate rooms and a nice big reception room. Love an inglenook, but I know that's probably asking too much. So a fireplace of any kind that we can, make it our own would be fine. A utility room. I'd love to have a utility room, but...
What about outside? You're looking for a little business venture, aren't you?
I think on the outside, yes. We're looking to perhaps develop a holiday let annex situation with the house, whether it's something that's existing already in the house or something that we can
convert
from outbuildings.
To get all of that might be a little bit of a squeeze. Anything that where you were able to compromise?
Yeah, of course. I mean, we'll look at anything. I think the thing we don't want to compromise on is the land.
Uh-huh. And how much land
annex.
Do you want?
Well, you said half an acre plus.
I think half an acre plus, really. I think half an acre would give me the chance to develop a nice garden.
In terms of the location, what are you looking for? In the middle of nowhere with amazing views, or do you want to be in a little town?
On the edge of a village.
Oh, yeah.
Or outside, 2 or 3 miles outside, we don't mind.
No.
Views is definitely something I've really hankered at having. I'd love to be able to walk out my back door and there is this rolling countryside.
So you want it all?
I do, absolutely.
Views,
why not?
Annex, land,
exactly.
The kitchen
diner. Well, might as well start up and then we can work our way down.
What's your budget for all this?
Well, we'd like 440, but if that's not possible, 475.
So we've got a bit of everything lined up for you.
Great.
And I can't wait to show you.
Likewise.
Come with me. This way.
For their top budget of £475,000, Fergie and Graham would love a character stone property, a big kitchen and a minimum of 3 bedrooms. Outside, they'd like a garden that Graham can get to work in and a workshop space, plus an annex or the potential to create a space to use as a holiday let. They're hoping for wonderful views and an edge of village location. I'll be showing Fergie and Graham a fabulous selection of properties, and once we've completed a tour of each, I'll reveal the asking price. Our final visit will take them to a very special mystery house, which you could say is the ultimate escape.
I want to know about this business bit.
We did talk about B&B initially, but because Fergie's travelling down to London for the next 18 months, we thought an annex would be better where somebody can come
terrible.
In and be self-contained. And
yeah, it is.
You can't do breakfast.
The content's there, but It's the presentation artist.
To kickstart our Northumberland journey, we're heading to the village of Haydon Bridge, towards the south of the county. Surrounded by lush green countryside, today's village is divided by the river South Tyne and linked by its elegant bridge, but the original village lay a mile to the north. There's a good sense of community here and a variety of independent shops and eateries. The train station allows for an easy journey to London and is just a 10-minute walk from our first property. Perched on the edge of the village, it overlooks the Tyne Valley.
Righty-ho, house number one.
Yeah.
Built from scratch by the present owners, and as you see, it really makes a lot of the fantastic views.
Yes.
It doesn't have an annex.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You would have to think about doing something here with this big garage.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. The house is lovely, and the views are stunning.
So we don't need to go in, so?
No. No, not yet.
No, come
nearly.
On.
We'll see.
We will see.
We will
when
see.
We go through the door.
This handsome stone house, with its smart slate roof, was built in 2001, but its facade has the character of a home much older. We're entering into a large hallway and going straight to the sitting room at the back of the house. It really sets the tone for how this property makes the most of its surroundings.
I wanted to bring you in here first, because this is what this house is all about.
Yes. Wonderful
That's
views.
Fantastic.
Isn't it great?
Amazing
yes.
views.
An open space. I like the window, you know, the picture window.
I love the whole stone look. I mean, that really is what we love, yeah. isn't it? Yeah.
There's another more formal reception room at the front of the property, and next stop for us is the kitchen, just behind us. Its internal window means the sitting room's view can be enjoyed from here.
Bit smaller than I had hoped for, but still very usable.
Yeah. My thoughts about the kitchen is that you could perhaps open it up to make yeah. more of that space.
Yes, so you had the whole open kitchen, diner, living area, which would be very nice because you'd have those amazing
yeah.
views.
Yes.
On the other side here, you've got a utility room that's pretty much the same size as the kitchen. But you might want to use that utility room as the kitchen facilities for the...
Yes, of course, of yes. course, of course.
Yes. I'll let you explore that. You've got a huge garage yeah. which you could convert into living space.
Adjoining the utility room, the double garage is currently used for storage. And there's also a study on this floor. Then moving upstairs, there's a family bathroom servicing three of four bedrooms. They're all at the back of the house, each benefiting from views across the valley. A dressing room leads to the largest of the four bedrooms.
Very nice. Nice big room.
Yeah. Nice high ceiling.
And because you've got the dressing room, you've got plenty of storage without, you know, encroaching on the bedroom with wardrobes and that.
And there's a nice big ensuite big through there
view.
As well.
Lovely.
But again, it's all about the views. You've got this
it
views.
Is. The views are amazing. I like my bedroom to be my sanctuary.
This is half as big again as what we have now.
Yeah, it is. It's lovely.
With warm reactions to the inside of the house, it's now time to take in the sunshine where the breathtaking views are best appreciated from the rear garden. It's surrounded by flower beds, low hedges and patio areas. There's a large shingle driveway to the front which offers further possibilities, and the whole plot is about a third of an acre.
It's pretty nice, huh?
Goodness, wow, you know.
Have a lovely view, nice open space.
It's fantastic.
It's quite a chunk of house from the back, isn't it?
Yes.
It's huge. Yes. Actually, you don't realise when you're standing at the front how much it goes back.
Yeah. Mm. Now, the garden, Graham, mm-hmm. is this enough or is this too small?
I think initially I would be thinking at looking something slightly bigger and perhaps slightly more level. But it would be a challenge, but it's not something I'd be worried about taking on.
Because also there's no workshop for your furniture mm-hmm. business
no.
either.
Yeah. No. Workshops can be built or bought.
What do you think the price of this is? How much would you have to pay to own it?
$495,000.
Oh, over your budget.
Yes, yes.
I, on the other hand, am optimistic. So I'm going to go under our budget and say $430,000.
$430,000. Well, mm-hmm. the actual asking price is $450,000.
Oh, okay.
Why don't you go around and have a look? And when you're done, I'll meet you at the front.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Under the top budget by £25,000, this four-bedroom stone property is all about one thing, the views. There are options for a great kitchen diner, and the largest sitting room has a spectacular picture window. Along with a pretty garden, there's money left over and space for Graham to build his workshop. All this with amenities nearby, including a station for Ferga.
It's a big space, isn't it?
Yeah.
This would be ideal as the annex. You could use the utility room and then put a wonderful window in there which makes the most of the views.
Yeah.
Beautiful house, lovely stone character property with a wonderful living room with an amazing big window. Yeah, I could see myself living here. It's a lovely house.
I think the lounge is the room for me, with the working fireplace, somewhere to relax. We've not had a fireplace in our house for many years, and so that is my favourite room. It's nice and large and good to relax in.
Yeah, I think we both can see the potential. I think the downside probably for Graham will be the land. And a little bit for me, but I think we could make it work.
Oh, it's lovely in Northumberland. I'm so glad they chose to buy a house here. Are you all done?
Absolutely. That was wonderful.
Well, that's house number one done and dusted.
Uh-huh.
Let's head off for house number two.
Great.
Right.
The stunning Northumberland landscape is what's drawing Ferga and Graham to the county, and they hope it'll be a draw for holiday let guests too. They're also planning on growing their own produce, which their visitors can enjoy. One local who makes the most of not only homegrown but wild produce is Linus Morton. He's been foraging since he was a child, and for the past 5 years, he's been running courses in foraging and wild food in the heart of the Northumberland countryside. Ferga and Graham are meeting him on a friend's glamping site in the Tarset Valley.
So, Linus, why is Northumberland so good for foraging and picking wild foods?
We've got so many different habitats. We've got wonderful woodlands and pastures.
Well, Linus, I see you've got a combination of plants in your basket, but the thing that would concern me, I think, would be how do you know what's not poisonous, what is, what's good for you?
The best way, if you're unsure, is to come out with an expert, somebody who can show you how to identify all the wild plants and also like show you how to find them.
So what goodies have you got in the basket, Linus?
I've got a few wild plants that are quite common around here. Mm-hmm. This is a common sorrel, which is quite an interesting flavour, if you'd like to try.
I'll try it.
Yeah. So it's got a very sharp, lemony flavour to it.
Cheers.
And we have this quite pretty plant, which is Lady Smock.
Lady Smock. Just take the top part.
Yeah, we'll just take the top part and have a try of that. And it's got quite a surprising little punch.
It's really nice.
Mm.
Yeah, it's lovely.
And peppery.
Ooh, that's a strong taste. Very strong, yeah. Very pungent.
With foraging off the menu today because of the wet weather, Linus's wife Louise has prepared a wild lunch in their food wagon, a bespoke mobile kitchen. It's being served in a yurt, and it's a chance to stay dry and find out a little about their self-sufficient lifestyle and business.
This all looks fabulous. What are we going to be eating now?
We've got nettle seed bread here, topped with lacto-fermented garlic leaf, elderberry balsamic vinegar, wild mushroom pate from mushrooms from the woods that you've just been through.
How did you get involved in this lifestyle in the country?
There's so much here, just in Northumberland.
Yeah.
And we've been living in Newcastle for years as well. And we eventually just went, why don't we move to the country?
So that's your chosen lifestyle. Now you're looking to educate other people through your business.
Yeah, and inspire them to do this themselves, to come out and see what's in the landscape, because foraging is a great way of engaging more deeply with the landscape. It's a kind of walk with a purpose. You're going outside, you're enjoying the countryside and a beautiful place, but at the same time, you're learning more deeply about the species that are present there, and also, you know, you're bringing back some delicious, healthy food.
What kind of clientele do you get?
Mainly people from, I would say, from urban dwellers, then people from the cities who are coming out to experience a day in the country.
One of the things that when we move to the country we're going to hopefully have is a holiday let. Do you think that there's been a surge in tourism in Northumberland?
Northumberland for a long time was just a day destination. People used to come out, do a little bit of walking, a bit of activities, and then go home at the end of it. But now with the expansion of many developments such as this, that providing accommodation for people in Northumberland is now becoming much more of a destination for people to go and stay for weekends and weeks and take breaks. It's such a beautiful place. It feels like you have the place to yourself.
Yeah.
And you can go out and you can walk all day, and all you can experience is the landscape. Quite a special experience.
I'm looking forward to it.
We are lucky because not only does the countryside provide us with a wonderful lifestyle, but wonderful food too.
It looks delicious. Can we get stuck in?
Our couple seem inspired by the quality of life their move here would mean. Having sampled Northumberland's wild harvest, it's time to resume our house hunt. For our next property stop, we're heading to the hamlet of Redpath, in the southwest of the county. 2 miles away is the small town of Holtwhistle, whose charming streets offer a good selection of essentials. It's one of two areas laying claim to being located in the geographical centre of Great Britain, and there are reminders at every turn. Just under a 10-minute drive takes us to our second offering. Less than 2 miles from the local station and just over a mile from Hadrian's Wall is this double-fronted stone cottage.
House number two.
Wow, can I say wow lots of times?
You said it 3 times, that's great.
Great, who comes a fourth? Wow.
This is a lovely house.
This is a beautiful house. Mm.
So not the edge of a village, we're a little bit more remote.
Can we afford it?
You'll find out. So the core of the building goes back to the 1800s. It's actually, it would have been 3 agricultural workers' families lived on each floor.
Wow.
Big plot, just under an acre, 0.8 of an acre.
Mm-hmm.
Big double garage for your workshop.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
But that's not all. Follow me.
Not only am I showing them the stone-built house they've asked for, but it also comes with a pretty stone holiday cottage, or bothy, which is just opposite the house.
Your very own bothy.
Lovely bothy. Love it. Fantastic.
Let's have a look inside.
I'd love to.
The bothy is detached and has its own cottage garden.
Come on in. They've kept it very, very simple, which I think is a good thing. It's just a bedroom and a little ensuite through here.
Wonderful.
No kitchenette. They give them breakfast in the morning and a little basket in the porch.
It's gorgeous. It's just my taste. It's minimalist, but stylish. Stunning. I love it.
And they do it very low-key through the internet. They don't really push it. They don't advertise it. Yeah. And they make $3,000 a year.
Mm-hmm.
Is that right? That's OK. So, in fact, if you did push it, you could probably do a lot better.
Holiday let sorted, now back across the lane to the main house, which was extended in the 1980s and is laid out over 3 levels. We're starting on the ground floor, where there's a dining room and drawing room at the front and a kitchen with utility at the back.
Come into the kitchen, first of all. What do you think of this?
Triple wow.
Good space. Good space, isn't it? Look at the view as well.
Not usually lost for words, but this is gorgeous.
So the layout is very lovely here because you've got a beautiful front room, nice and sunny, because it's south-facing, the sun comes in that side.
Yeah.
And then the dining room on the other side. You've got the kitchen, nice big utility room here.
Oh, you do?
Yeah. Upstairs we've got 2 bedrooms. This is a 3-storey house.
Yes, so we've got another story beneath us.
She's fantastic. On the ball.
Hi.
Up on the first floor, the bright master bedroom has its own stylish ensuite shower room, and there's a beautifully finished bathroom for the second bedroom, also a double. Down on the lower ground floor, there's a 3rd, smaller bedroom with a neighbouring shower room, and there's a study next door. In addition, there's a rather large, impressive sitting room.
Wow.
Look at this.
Fantastic.
It's Aladdin's cave, isn't it?
Yes.
A wonderful building, lovely house. And 3 levels makes it much more interesting, and they use the space so fantastically well.
And one nice feature is that you can go straight into the garden from here.
That's good.
Outside, there's a large terrace, a summer house, a bordered lawn, and of course the views Fergus spotted earlier.
Out in the beautiful garden, you can see the real height of the property. Those 3 stories really add up from back here.
It's a solid, really solid house.
It's a beautiful house, beautiful house.
And the garden is nicely zoned. You've got this beautiful dry stone wall down one side.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a woodland at the back, which is yours. And then also the slope down, not quite to the field, is also yours.
Yes.
Nice.
Yeah. I think it's a good size. I think because the house gives us everything we want, we've
so
got
many
the bothy.
Options.
we've got the bedrooms, it'd be nice to think that the garden could be dedicated to borders and focal points, really.
What do you think it's on the market for?
£475. I think it's right on our budget, if not above, but I'll go
£475. I think I'll go for £500,000.
Graham is a little closer. Unfortunately, it is over budget.
Yeah.
It's on at £495.
Not surprising.
So £495,000. Mm-hmm. But the owners are keen to move and they're willing to take an offer.
Right. Yeah, I'm overcome with excitement. Yeah.
Well, have a stroll around your three floors and your less than an acre of land. And I will catch you when you're done. That might be some time.
But, I think it will be. I think we'll be having a good stroll through. Thank you. Look. Okay.
Granted, this gorgeous 19th century stone property might be £20,000 above their budget, but with the vendor open to offers, it could be within reach. It has both character and style, with a superb kitchen diner, three reception rooms and three bedrooms. Outside, there's not only a pretty garden with views, but also a detached holiday cottage for paying guests. The nearest amenities are less than 2 miles away.
This is gorgeous. Look at it again, all those windows and
nice fireplace. Beautiful fireplace.
Log burner. Perfect. This just hits everything I wanted, apart from massive amount of land. The house is just beautiful. It's beautifully done. It's the style we love. It's, you know, the rooms are all really good size. The kitchen is gorgeous. I just, you know, I could wax lyrical for ages about it. It's just such a lovely, lovely home.
As soon as we turned up outside, this house really gave me a tingle in the stomach. I know it affected Fergus a little slightly more emotionally. But yes, it's really got everything that we're looking for in a house.
This is a magical spot. I so hope they can sort out the finances and get this house. Hello.
Hello.
I was just singing the praises of this house and how happy you seem in it.
Yes, I do seem very happy in it. I think it was made for me.
Well, let's take the evening off because tomorrow is the mystery house and you never know.
Yes.
It's the second day of our Northumberland journey on the hunt for a country pad for Fergus and Graham from Croydon, South London. For their top budget of £475,000, they'd like a character stone property with the potential for a holiday let. Still to come, we brave the elements on the way to our mystery house.
Quite remote.
Yes.
Very.
Yes. Not overlooked.
And I'll be getting to grips with 2,000-year-old armour.
When you touch things like that, chills go down your spine. Day two of our property hunt here in Northumberland, and the weather's a little bit damper than yesterday, but it's not dampening our spirits, because Graham and Fergus seemed to really fall in love with house number two yesterday. Even though it wasn't really in a village or even on the edge of a village, it did offer them pretty much everything they wanted. The mystery house, however, is a very different offering. Properties like this do not come on the market very often, so we have to show it to them. But will it be a step too far when it comes to being in the wilderness?
For the mystery property, we're travelling to the historic hamlet of Coldclough in the south of the county. In the heart of the North Pennines area of outstanding natural beauty, it's just a couple of miles away from the small village of Nenthead in Cumbria. Built in the mid-1700s, it was one of the earliest purpose-built industrial villages in Britain. It was a centre for lead and silver mining. Our remote mystery house was originally two mine workers' cottages and dates back to the 1820s. Elevated almost 1,800 feet above sea level, it offers panoramic views of the surrounding landscape.
This is your mystery house.
Wow.
It's very striking, Alison, very striking.
It is striking, yes. Isn't it? Quite remote.
Yes.
Very.
Yes. not overlooked.
It's definitely not overlooked, but we really wanted to show you this because it's quite unique and very high up. This is used to be the highest village in England, we think. And it was a lead mining community back in the day, in the 1800s. Now there's just a couple of properties scattered around.
Yes.
But what's
unique
about this is that it's cost neutral.
Wow. So it's an eco house.
It's an eco house. The wind turbine generates all the energy that you need, and you get paid a subsidy for the energy that you create.
Right. That's a good benefit.
That's a very good benefit.
So all we have to do is pick our way across the valley to get there.
Great.
The wild weather seems rather fitting on this expanse of moorland as we're blown towards our mystery house, which has been renovated extensively by the current owners. The front porch takes us straight into the kitchen.
Oh, so come into the warmth.
It's beautiful and it's really cosy.
Look at the stone flag floors, beautiful.
Gorgeous, yeah.
These are the original flags. Lovely. Nice kitchen.
Lovely kitchen, yes. Country kitchen.
So you've got to understand this is a very different offering from the other properties we've shown, because it's really, it's not quite what you asked for, but that's what the mystery house often is.
Yes, yeah.
Because this is really much more like you're way out into the wild open expanses, you're very self-contained and you're very self-sufficient. Is it attractive?
Yeah, I think it is.
I think so, yes.
It's such a beautiful place. The landscape and all of that reminds me very much of Ireland. Uh-huh. You know, it's very similar, so there's kind of an emotional connection there.
So just keep a very open mind. It's a very different offering, but it's this end I want to show you next.
Off the kitchen, there's a boot room and a utility, both with access to the outside. And off the utility is a handy little study. Moving to the other side of the kitchen, we're passing through a large family room to a beautiful sitting room with the most stunning outlook.
Feast your eyes on this.
Impressive room to relax and
unwind. Unbelievable. This is a room with a view again.
This is a room with a view.
And in fact, this is a room with an astounding view.
It's invigorating, really.
It is.
Yeah. You've got a little log burner here, just the right size for a room this size.
Yes. Yeah. You could just move right in and be so comfortable and so happy in somewhere like this, and it is a real home. It's a really loving home.
In many ways, the package is really for you. It doesn't have an annex.
No. Mm-hmm.
But if you were to, you know, have a holiday let, I mean, it's a great draw because it's just uninterrupted views, fantastic walking, and amazing stargazing.
Yes, I bet you've absolutely no or little light pollution out here, probably no light pollution at all. So there's this, when you get the starry nights, they must be stunning.
Yeah. Let's have a look upstairs.
The remote location of our mystery house brings with it so many pluses, and I'm pleased that Fergus and Graham are embracing them. It's hard not to. On the first floor, there's a family bath and shower room servicing three double bedrooms, all with spectacular views. Time to explore the master.
This is the biggest, the one that they use. It's got all the fitted wardrobes all the way around.
Plenty of storage space, great views.
It's
gorgeous. Yes.
I think it's one of those houses you think about when you're thinking about retirement and your own little bolt hole.
Yes.
And it's a bit crazy because we're snug and warm inside, but let's head outside and we can look at all the magical green wind and turbine apparatus.
Okay.
And talk about the price. Okay.
The house has an integral garage, potentially a workshop for Graham. The front garden is laid to lawn and surrounded by dry stone walling, and there are seating areas to enjoy the view from every angle. To the rear, there's the terrace. The small stone building in front of the wind turbine was once used to store explosives for the lead miners and now houses the working of the turbine. Behind it, there's an extra parcel of land.
I won't keep you out here too long, but what do you think the price tag for this one is?
I haven't got the foggiest notion, Alistair, but I'm going to go with $445,000.
Mm-hmm. Graham?
Well, I'm going to go slightly less. I'm going to go for $425,000.
Very good. Well, in this case, the price may be a cruncher because it's on at $495,000. But it's a unique property. Yes, we had to bring it here.
It's an incredible property.
So why don't you go and explore? You can look at the turbine, you can tinker around in all the spaces, and we'll find somewhere dry to reconvene.
Okay. All right. Great. Thank you.
Our remote eco-mystery house has rung in £20,000 above budget, although its energy-saving features mean it's a money saver. It's full of character inside with a great country kitchen, a sitting room with a fabulous outlook, and three bedrooms. Outside, the property's isolated location means it comes with 360-degree views of dramatic open moorland.
So cosy and so warm and homely.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it's just me being fanciful, but it's got an amazing energy about it. Mm. My first thoughts was unbelievably stunning situation with the amazing countryside around it, the hills, and a gorgeous stone property. Beautiful. Just took my breath away. And as we've gone through the house, it's just, you know, every room has been a delight.
As a house, it's fantastic. It's cosy, it's warm. And it's the type of structure that we like. It's beams, it's stone, and it's big thick walls and log burners.
Yesterday I thought we'd found the one, but coming here today and being in this property, it's definitely thrown a spanner in the works, and we'll have to give it some serious consideration.
Right, come on then, let's get you somewhere nice and warm and dry, and we can discuss all the houses.
Great, thank you.
Northumberland's position bordering Scotland has seen it experience many turbulent times. One of the most fascinating, iconic monuments has to be Hadrian's Wall. Built in the 2nd century, in the reign of the Emperor Hadrian, it was the northern frontier of the Roman Empire, stretching from east to west coast, covering 73 miles. Today, it's a UNESCO World Heritage Site. I've come to the remains of a Roman settlement in Corbridge, close to the wall, to meet historian Dr. Francis McIntosh.
I love Roman history, particularly in Britain, because it was such a flourishing civilization, then it sort of vanished. Tell me about Corbridge.
Hadrian's Wall, 2 miles north. We were here before Hadrian's Wall. We quite like that claim to fame. The Romans settled at Corbridge around the late 70s AD, and there were successive forts right through till about the 160s.
OK, so there's a big fort here.
Uh-huh.
Lots of centurions. Are they sort of people from Italy who come all this way?
No. At that stage, most of the soldiers might not have been from Italy. They were legionary soldiers and auxiliaries, part of the invasion force, a real mixture.
And then the wall is built when?
122, building starts, but it's finished by the 130s.
Midway through the 2nd century AD, Hadrian's Wall was permanently garrisoned, meaning no need for a fort at Corbridge, and that's when the fort fell out of use.
The civilians who are living in the town outside the fort move in, and it becomes a fully civilian settlement.
And when did it all kind of come to its end?
Well, officially, you know, the end of Roman Britain's 410, so we know that Hadrian's Wall was de-garrisoned by that point, and Corbridge the same. It kind of slides into decline from the early 5th century.
And when was it rediscovered? Because it's some pretty impressive ruins you've got here.
But the first serious excavations were in 1906.
The footprint of this town is one of the most significant finds in British Roman history and provides vital archaeological evidence of how our ancestors lived.
Ah, so exciting.
Oh, we've made it to the granaries.
This is the granaries?
That's right, yeah. We're standing on the floor, the dried goods have been on, but this raised floor allows air circulation and it also keeps it away from, you know, vermin, rats and things. Huh.
I mean, it's incredible. So these are original Roman flags?
Absolutely, yeah.
It's amazing how they built to last. I mean, this is 2,000 years old, really.
Exactly.
What are we talking about in terms of the inhabitants? I mean, are the Romans now married to the British?
Yeah, I think there's a lot more blurring of lines, particularly on Hadrian's Wall. We know lots of soldiers had families with them. Some of them would have been local. Here, we've got traders coming in from all over the empire. We know we had people from Greece living here, people coming in from different regions to sell material to the soldiers. It's a lot less black and white.
Just over half a century ago, one of the most important Roman time capsules ever discovered was unearthed, allowing a unique insight into those times. In 1964, the remains of a wooden chest were discovered, containing artifacts that became known as the Corbridge Hoard. They're just some of the 34,000 pieces at the museum here, too many to display all at once. So Francis is going to show me some hidden treasures.
This is actual Roman centurion armour.
Yeah, and you see this bit here is curved. That's because that part would have been near your neck.
Unbelievable that that's lasted so long. No, 2,000 years old.
Yeah, pretty much.
When you touch things like that, chills go down your spine. What else have we got? So, here's some jewellery.
So this is a penannular brooch, which is made from copper alloy, and it would have been worn up near the shoulder to hold the cloak on. They didn't have zips, you know, they didn't have Velcro, so if you need to hold your clothes on, these are one of the only things you've got.
And do you have any other favourite finds?
Yeah, one of the pieces is this little vessel. So this is a Roman perfume or oil flask. These flasks are very, very rare. You know, there's less than 20 of them in the empire. So we're really lucky to have such a great example. And this is our Roman.
What's that?
It's a dodecahedron, so a 12-sided object. It's a descriptive name for its shape, but nobody knows what it's for. There's lots of theories out there, from candlesticks to predicting the time of the harvest. So he's quite chunky compared to the armour.
Oh, yeah.
Because he's not very corroded. So he's made from copper alloy, and it's in a remarkable condition.
That is so wonderful that we don't know what it is. It's like a mystery object.
Exactly.
I think it's my favourite item ever.
Oh,
a dodecahedron.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for giving us a peek behind the scenes.
Not at all.
It feels like a real privilege.
Glad you've enjoyed it.
History rocks, huh?
Yes, it does.
How fascinating to witness such a well-preserved slice of Roman history, hidden for 2,000 years, giving us an insight today into a civilization gone by.
So I've got Ferga and Graham inside, keeping warm by the fire, and let's find out which of the houses they fell in love with. We're finally warm and dry.
Yes, yeah, at last.
So that is part of Northumberland. Bit of rain, bit of wind. How has it been? Have you got a favourite?
Yes, we do.
Yes, we have.
And I don't think it's any secret. House number two.
Yes.
Yeah, it was stunning. Beautifully put together, fantastic. Mm. Everything we wanted.
So as soon as I saw it, I liked the construction. The stone was great. The garden looked fabulous. This has got the bothy. I say it had everything that we wanted, and I can see myself keeping myself busy there for many years to come.
It did feel like a perfect fit for you two. We were a bit worried that it might be a bit remote, but that doesn't seem to bother you.
I didn't think it was remote at all. Mm. I mean, in comparison to House 3, it wasn't remote at all. It was, you know...
Nothing is remote compared to the mystery house. And what happens next?
We'd like to go back and have another look at house number two and then make an offer.
make an offer!
I know, it's music to your ears, Alistair.
Yes. We felt at home straight away as soon as we went into the front.
I don't think we're going to better it. I think no matter how long we look, I don't think we'll better that one. We're ready to go. I mean, we're mentally ready. And it's just a case of now getting the stars aligned so we can move on. And then start saying my prayers on the rosary beads that our house sells very quickly.
I do hope that all the ducks line up, because it's a beautiful house for you two, and I can imagine you having a very happy, long stretch there.
Yeah, I think so too. So, you know, thank you very much. It's been a great experience this week. We've loved every minute, haven't we?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm so delighted that Ferga and Graham's house hunt brought us up to Northumberland. It's a wonderful county, even under summer rain, and we don't come here half enough. And I could tell that that second house is going to be a perfect fit for them. The minute I saw Ferga see the bothier, her eyes lit up, and the same thing happened with Graham and that garden. So I hope that their house sale in Croydon goes through smoothly. And I hope that you join us next time for more Escape to the Country.
And I'm thrilled to report that Ferga and Graham's offer on house number two was accepted. So all being well and good, it'll soon become theirs. And we wish them the very best of luck with their move to Northumberland. If you'd like to escape to the country in England, Scotland, Wales or Northern Ireland and need our help, you can apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.